only just beginning. Senator Jack Reed of Rhode Island is with us. He's a member of both the Intelligence and Armed Services Committees. First of all, have you been briefed on these incidents?
No, it's been breaking so quickly that there's been no formal briefing, and frankly, most of my colleagues are dispersed across the country.
Has your office been warned, be careful, watch out what you're getting in the mail?
We have screening devices in place in the Senate and the House. And we're consciously and alert for these types of packages. But before it reaches us, it's been carefully screened.
But have they told you that there's a greater threat today as opposed to yesterday?
I have not heard that directly.
Because they're apparently, they're looking at various, at least one suspicious device addressed to somebody in the U.S. House or Senate that they're looking at right now here in the Washington, D.C. area.
That could be the case. There's multiple targets, and there could be many more. That's disturbing.
So what's your reaction when you hear that someone was sending bombs, acts of terror, potentially murder, to two former presidents, a former Secretary of State, a former Attorney General, a former CIA director, and CNN, and others, presumably? What's your reaction to that?
It is an attack on our government, our Constitution. These are people who have enjoyed the trust and the support of the American people to lead us, two presidents, as you point out, a Secretary of State. And so it's not just an individualized attack, it's an attack on our system of government, our Constitution. And as you pointed out, and I think it's quite obvious, some of this is a reflection of the debased tone of debate. And when the President of the United States is at a rally and smiles as people chant, lock her up, or make direct attacks on the news media, that doesn't raise the level of debate, that lowers it. And it creates this environment where these acts could take place. And not only being an attack, I think the other thing has to point out, this is an act of profound cowardice. Someone is sending an explosive device anonymously to people who could be hurt, and this is something that is just disreputable.
And it's not just let's not forget, it's not just these individuals whose name was on the envelope, on the address, but there are postal workers,
absolutely,
there are clerical workers, there are a lot of people who might have access, who might have to deal with this, and especially if, as John Miller, the head of counterterrorism in New York, where the New York Police Department says, there was suspicious powder found in these packages as well.
Right. I mean, it's unlikely that a former president of the United States will receive mail that has
secret
not been screened.
Secret Service will take care of it.
So he is a Secret Service agent, a public servant, a postal worker. In fact, one of the surprising things with five or six devices, they're fairly sophisticated if they didn't detonate en route. I mean, most times these sort of homemade weapons, the danger is that they'll detonate prior to their delivery. So, but you're exactly right. These are postal workers. These are average men and women who are doing their jobs, and they could be the victims.
So what's your message to President Trump right now? If he's watching you, what do you say to him?
He has to stand up personally, not through a Twitter message or endorsing someone else's statement, and very calmly talk about this is a threat to our Constitution. And then he has to begin to raise the tenor of comments about public life here. He can't condone, you know, these chants of lock her up, et cetera. That's unpresidential. He has to now step up as a president and call us all to a much higher level of conduct and debate and discussion.
For him to acknowledge, for him to say, you know what, I apologize, I was wrong, I didn't mean it, and those who think, you know, along the lines of what I was suggesting are taking these kinds of dastardly steps, please don't do it. That's not in his nature.
I don't think it is, frankly, but at least he has to draw a clear line between this tenor of abuse and personal attack and acrimony and raise his discussion. He can set the example. He can start talking about policies based upon facts, based upon what's in the best interest of the United States. We could disagree about that, but it doesn't have to be personalized. It doesn't have to be, you know, really, frankly, a reality TV host going for ratings. It's got to be a president.
You've been in Washington for a while. You've been around for a while. Have you ever seen anything like this emanating, the kind of language from a president of the United States?
No, all of the presidents I've had the opportunity to work with, from George Herbert Walker Bush, President Clinton, President George W. Bush, President Obama, have taken upon themselves to actually raise the level if they felt it was the public was sort of slipping into personalized attacks. They did it in a very conscious way. They looked upon the presidency as an office that had to be respected, and their behavior had to reflect the kind of solemn and important duties of president.
I know you take this very seriously. You and I went to Iraq together back several years ago. You're a former U.S. Army Ranger. You work hard as a politician, as a United States Senator, but also you remember your military background, and it's very disturbing to see what's going on right now.
I think it is, because, again, you think about the thousands and thousands of young Americans all across the globe that are dedicating themselves to our protection. I don't think they'd behave this way. They understand the respect, and they understand the importance of what they say and what they do.
Yeah, they want some important, very poignant words from the president, the commander-in-chief, right now.
Yes.
Let's see if we hear it. Senator Reid, thanks so much for joining
us. Thanks, Wolf.